I'd like to thank everybody for coming out tonight and joining us for our final coaches clinic. And if you guys that have been here in the past, you know we've had a really good lineup, and we're going to conclude that tonight with Mr. Ron Davenport. I'm going to start off by telling you a little bit about Ron and his background, and then he's going to go in and talk a little bit about hitting. Ron attended Leesville Road High School, and in 2000, he was very excited about signing with Florida State University to play collegiate baseball. However, that year, the Toronto Blue Jays decided they wanted to draft him in the 22nd round of the Major League Baseball draft, and he decided to chase his dream and pursue professional baseball. Ron went on to play 10 seasons of professional baseball, 7 years with the Blue Jays, 1 year with the Milwaukee Brewers, the Pittsburgh Pirates, and 1 year with the Long Island Ducks of the Independent Atlantic League. Ron was a two-time All-Star, 2008 Camden River Sharks. This particular year, he batted 332, 18 home runs, and 93 RBIs. He also participated in the Home Run Derby that year. In 2004, with the Florida State League, with Dunedin, batted 278, 16 home runs, 92 RBIs. Another venture that Ron went out on recently was with the King in His Court. He served as a starting shortstop, traveling four-man softball team that competed against nine-man softball teams. And they were very successful and won the majority of those games. Ron currently serves as a batting instructor, baseball hitting and pitching instructor at Grand Slam USA here in Raleigh. He's also volunteer assistant coach on various baseball teams with USA Baseball. Again, this is Ron Davenport. I'd like to turn over the show to him, and thank y'all for coming.
Thank you for having me. Like you said, played at Leesville. And did grew up in Greenville, North Carolina. Lived there for 10 years. Came up here as a sophomore. New to competition, was a little bit stronger up in the Raleigh area. You know, names like Josh Hamilton, Mike Prochaska, Daniel Caldwell, and we came up here to get a little bit more competition, a little bit more of getting in front of college coaches, pro scouts, and all that kind of stuff. So my mom's a school teacher, or was at Lockhart Elementary for 15 years, right around the corner here, and. Graduated in 2000, 6 days after I got graduated, got drafted by the Blue Jays. 5 days later, I'm in Medicine Hat, Canada, 3,000 miles away, playing with the Medicine Hat Blue Jays in their rookie ball. Never been away from home, 18 years old. It's quite a shock, but you know, always something I knew I wanted to do was play baseball, is number first and foremost. Kind of changed, obviously, over the years, but you know, as you go through minor league baseball, you realize there's prospects and there's suspects, as they call them. They might not want to tell you that, but you know, there's guys that they put a lot of effort into, and those guys are there. And the rest of us, you know, as you play your way through, you're either producing or you're not. And you know, I know y'all had Jerry Sands come in here a couple of weeks ago, big time prospect, big power prospect now with the Pirates, I believe. But you know, after 10 years of playing, I knew it was going to be. If I wanted to keep playing, it was going to be playing to play and playing to have fun, and that would have been fine. But it comes a time when you move on, and you know, I love coaching kids. I do about, I'd say, 10 to 15 lessons a week at Grand Slam USA in Raleigh off of Western Boulevard, where the Kmart is. And I've been doing that for about 3 years now after I retired in 09. For the last 2 years, like you said, I actually got hooked up with King in His Court and was their shortstop. Pitcher was 65 years old, catcher was 55, first baseman was 46, and then I was 28, 29. And so I got every ball that was hit. First baseman had a plastic hip, so I did everything. But just showcase if anybody's ever seen it. Raise your hand if you have. Yeah, okay. How many have seen it set twice? No, that's about right. But, you know, Eddie Fanner passed away in 07, but a guy named Rich Hoppe took over the team and kind of globetrotters of softball, as you know. But tonight, we're going to talk about hitting. Please feel free at any time, kids included, raise your hand and ask questions about anything in particular that you might not understand. It won't bother me getting interrupted by any means. If you want to know a little bit more, it's better to do it right then instead of doing everything and then going back to it. So please don't. You can interrupt all you want. It's not a problem. Hitting in general, especially, you know, ages obviously vary as what you're going to be teaching. Most of my, the youngest I like to do lessons with are 8 years old. I'd love to be 12 and up, just because there's a certain level of uniqueness, I guess, to a hitting swing that you can teach a 12-year-old or up that they can handle versus 8-year-old. There's more basic mechanics at the younger age. And that's why I don't like to make it very detailed at the younger age. So tonight, I guess I'm going to talk more simplistic with the, I know we have a lot of young kids here, and what are the ages? I mean, is it more T-ball, more little league coaches that we have in here? So max age would be 12 as far as coaches and everything? All right, good. Hitting, there's two things that, I mean, there's a lot of non-negotiables. One for me is your eyes. How many kids in here like to swing like this and their eyes like to see where it goes? Raise your hands. Yeah, go. And if you're not raising your hands, you're not telling the truth. All right, there you go. Your eyes. You've got to see it to hit the ball. So when I'm here, I'm coming through, and here's this. I know I'm going to be jumping around a lot, but if I'm coming through with my eyes and I'm down here on the ball and I'm getting ready to swing and all of a sudden I want to see where it goes, it raises my body up, it raises my bat up, and the majority of the balls are going to be right into the dirt. They're either going to be in the dirt because I've raised my bat, or I'm going to overcompensate and drop my hands, right, because I know my body's coming up. So number one is your eyes. It's got to be the most important. Nothing against, but I've never seen a blind baseball player. Seen one deaf, Curtis Pride, but never a blind one. Eyes, number one. Number two, swing at strikes. If I had to say there's one reason, if I had to say there's two reasons that I'm coaching today and not playing, one is didn't take steroids, so not playing anymore, but that's a whole another controversial issue. Number two is I didn't swing enough strikes. I'm a free swinger. There was one season I had 400 at-bats and had 10 walks. So I was getting a walk every 40 plate appearances. With the Blue Jays, they actually wanted it and almost mandated it to have a walk every 10 plate appearances. They want, Moneyball came along and they want to make sure you're getting on base, the on-base percentage. But how many hitters, especially when you see home runs on SportsCenter or big hits, how many pitches are right here when they're making contact? I mean, it's not a fluke that they hit the ball the way they do. Now, obviously, they have super talent on TV, and they can hit balls that are up here and down here and still drive them. But the majority of the well-struck baseballs are strikes. So, kids, how many have ever hit a ball or made contact? I want to say, how many people have ever swung at a pitch neck high? Yeah. How many has ever swung at a pitch eye high? Yeah. How many has ever swung one over their head? Actually passed over there. Me too. I've actually got a picture at home where I am making contact with a ball that's over. I swung like this. And this is professional baseball. I'm getting paid to play. And swing at a pitch like this. And it was foul ball and everything. But eyes and swinging at strikes. Nothing to do with the mechanics. It's just pure baseball, mental part of the game. All right, so getting into the actual swing. Like most people, start from the ground up. The ground's where the power comes from. It's your strong, solid base. Without it, you're not going to be able to drive the ball. And it's not so much about power as in home run power. We talk about power as in line drive power, ground ball power. Later in my career, my batting practice became, I want every ball that I hit to get to the outfield fence. Even if it's a ground ball that's a one hopper to the shortstop, I want to drive that ball, if nobody touched it, to get onto the outfield fence. So, I mean, power is not just home runs. And the power comes from the ground. So, with that being said, as I'm straddled here, obviously how much this gets straightened up. We want to stay out of extremes in baseball. You know, you talk about pitching. That's an extreme. This is an extreme, somewhere in between. As hitting with our base, when I'm here, when I get out this far, this is an extreme. So hitters, I want you to just be nice and natural. So if you're playing football, if you're playing linebacker, I want to be in that position. It's a correlation here. So I'm here, I'm nice and relaxed, my knees are bent. One thing I'd like to say is when I do a lot of lessons, I have a lot of kids that are either here with their feet, so I'm open, or closed. Baseball is hard enough sport as it is, especially hitting. I want to make it as simple as possible. At your age that you are now, we'll do it right here because it's a line, get them as even as possible, parallel, whatever you want to call it, because I want to make it simple. But when I'm coming here, as I'm striding, I want to stay on that line. So we're doing practices, get people on some kind of a line as they're doing drills, making sure that they can stay here. Because this practice of coming here, now I'm going to be cut off. Opening up, this hip's going to fly. So if we start off in a good position, we have a better chance of staying there. So as I'm here with this nice parallel position here, y'all saw how wide I am. When I'm coming to stride here, there's four S's I know a lot of people have heard. We'll do it this way here. Four S's: short, soft, slow, and straight. Okay? And that's going to be your stride. So I'm short. All we need is maybe 6 inches at the most. Again, this extreme here. How hard is it for me to get any kind of torque on the ball? So I'm staying short. Slow. The slower your feet are, the quicker your hands can be. So think of it like this. If I'm quick, it's going to slow my hands down because they can't move as fast as my feet are. So I want to be slow, and I want to be short. I want to be soft. So I know we've heard a lot of analogies before. Probably the one you've heard the most is like there's a raw egg right here, and you don't want to break it when we're striding. I like to think of it just the terminology. Don't think of it as a step. What I like to say is it's a reach. Now we're going ahead a little bit. When I'm loading, I'm reaching out. So basically, the only thing that's going forward in my load is my front foot. This would be a step. My hands have come forward, my body. Even if I keep my hands back on a step, now all I've got left are my arms, right? So now it's going to be a little bit difficult. So think of it as a reach as we're teaching it. Here, I'm reaching out. I'm talking about being in the inside balls of my feet, this big stuff here, because when I'm on my heels, I'm losing my balance. Think about your hands, how much your fingers do versus the palm. Well, the same thing with your feet, how much your toes actually control your body versus your heels. A lot more control up in here. So stay into the front, toes of your feet. All right, so we're getting into the stride here. Slow, short, straight, and soft. With that, I want you to think about one key word I like to talk about is separation. And the separation part of it is when this foot is going forward, I want my body, my hands going back a little bit. Now, there's some people that like to talk about coming back first and then striding, making it almost three-part swing, back, stride, swing. For me personally, it makes it difficult for me to keep my hands back. When I do that, I'm already back now, and now I'm striding, everything wants to come forward. I like to have just a little bit of separation, so I like to think of it as maybe even a rubber band that's tied to my right wrist and my front foot. Again, here comes that extreme. If I go here, that rubber band is going to break. I've stretched it too far. If I don't do enough, it's not going anywhere. It's just going to drop down if I released it. So somewhere in between where I'm reaching back and forward, and all it is 6 inches. I mean, elbow, what I'll say about the elbow is as long as it's not above the shoulder. I mean, I was an elbow up guy, but it's how you control it. So with this elbow here, I start up. When I come back, it's going to stay right in there for me. One of the key things we'll get back to later is this knob and keeping it down. I'll talk a little bit more about the base first, though. So we've taken our stride, and we're in this position. And now what we're going to do is I like my legs to start my swing. And what I mean by that is I get a lot of swings that are here, and then they come through as an after the fact. That's an arm swing. That's no power. That's rolling over a lot. So I like to think of it as I'm coming here, and as I'm coming forward, this swing, my knee is going to be driving to where I want to hit it. And what I mean by that is this knee doesn't go in the same place every time. Pretty advanced stuff, but with my knee, and I see a fastball outside, obviously I want to let the ball get deep, but I don't want to get my knee fully turned, as you can see from this vertical here, fully turned to hit the ball opposite field. It just counteracts here. I want to have a little bit less turn in my knee because that's where the force is going, to the opposite field. Now, if a ball's down the middle, then the knee comes here, and if it's inside, it's going to get a full rotation. But there's no sense for me, especially if an inside pitch, me to get right there and try to hit that ball. I'm fighting against my body. So as this knee is coming forward, slowly I'm bringing the knob down. These hands are leading, as all of you have heard. And the last thing to come through is the barrel, right? How many kids roll over? All of you, raise your hands. Roll over on a baseball? Right-handed hitters hitting ground balls at shortstop every at bat. There's one of two things happening. One, I'm too early. That happens a lot, timing. Two is I'm letting my hands have stopped and now they're going to come through. Pure physics tells me that if my hands are in front of the barrel when I make contact, that ball has got to go that way. If they're right in line, obviously right up the middle, and if I was hitting an inside pitch, it'd be in front. All right, so I mean, that's simple physics there. We want to try to stay inside the baseball as long as possible. So out here, what I'm trying to do is get in here inside and have my hands in front of the baseball, because the last thing I want is here. And then while I'm on that, yes, please. It depends. I mean, if your hands are in front of me as a left-handed hitter. Yeah, no, that's fine. Yes. Me as a left-handed hitter, my hands are in front of the baseball. It's going to go this way. Now, obviously, it's difficult here, but if an inside pitch, and talk about keeping your hands inside, I can still keep my hands here and the barrel will be a little bit behind. If y'all can see it here, it's still going to be behind. And that ball is maybe right center for me, left center as a right-handed hitter. But the biggest thing about it is keeping your hands inside the baseball. So I will jump ahead. When we talk about the tee, to make things very simple, this is an art in itself because I get a lot of kids that are a lot better hitters when I start throwing soft toss or pitching to them because they don't hit enough on the tee. This is where you learn your swing. So on a tee, personally, if we're going to have a plate here, I want my front foot right off this corner. Everybody's their own. I wanted to get as far back away from that pitcher as possible. I didn't care those curveballs. People say, well, if I'm back here, I can't hit the curveballs that are breaking down there. Well, they're balls. Don't swing at them, kids. So if I'm back here, I want to give myself as long as possible to see the ball. But when I'm on a tee, here, and now, as I'm coming through, I want to think about putting this bat right on my hip and straight across. So that ball's a little too far front. So I move it back. It's right on the back of the plate. So if I'm standing here, right on my hip, that's where I want to work on an outside pitch. All right, so it's standing right on the corner, and I'm going to be coming through and driving it in the opposite field. On a ball down the middle, what we want to do is take this bat, put it on our hip. My quad. And now put it straight across. So what that does is it brings the ball right into the middle. And then that's the ball down the middle. When you're working on the inside pitch, this is the most difficult one because some coaches will like to put it way up here or back in here or way up there or whatever it is. We try to get it to where it get right on the quad here and put it on about a 30 degree angle. I know that's pretty detailed, but when I'm here, I want to be able to get it out front because an inside pitch is not meant to hit back here. I mean, you see Jeter's the best that I know of taking that inside pitch and shooting it the right field. He lets it get way deep, but he can do it. He's got the talent. I didn't. So when I'm here, I'm coming through and I want to get here. That leads me to make contact out front. So it's just setting up a tee with about a 30 degree angle here. All right, going backwards now. Getting back to the base, getting back to your hips. You know, people ask linear versus rotational. You know, if I knew exactly what either one of them were, I could maybe tell you which one I like. But, you know, at this age, can't get too technical. I think there's personally a little bit of both in the swing. Linear is where I'm coming through and it's this way, I'm more forward. It's more of a fast pitch softball swing because it's more on plane and I'm here. Where rotational is I'm here and just rotating on this axis here to go through. What I want to make sure all the hitters do is to think of it going this way with their swing. So if I'm here as a hitter, and I'm not going to hit it, I'm going to set it up though. If I'm here taking this swing, I don't want, as soon as I get to contact, finish it over here. I want to make sure the swing is going this way, that if for some reason I let go of the bat doesn't fly in the stands over here or on the on-deck circle. If I were to let go of it by accident, that it would go straight at the pitcher. That's where my focus is, because I want this swing this way instead of pulling off. So think of that as hitters going through the ball. Now what that does though, is it can get us a little confused about contact. When I'm here, and I've been at fault with this as well, getting here and extending through where you're pushing to get out here. I realize now that that's not exactly what we want to happen. When we talk about extending through a baseball and going this way, you're getting to contact, and I've got here my hands up and down. I've got a bent elbow here where my elbow is close to my hip because this is a power stance. And now instead of pushing through with my arms, it's coming here and just going, it's that top hand that's going through the ball and finish instead of both of them like this. That's not a natural swing. Let's see here. I have you come up here if you won't mind. You mind? All right. So one thing I'd like to talk about is having this elbow. I'd like you to be a right-handed hitter. I know it's a big bat. All right. We're not going to hit it because the camera's right there, right? So I want you to come down in your strong position right here. We'll leave the ball there. Come right here as strong as you can and just keep the bat, hold it right here. Okay. So the one thing, not picking on him because he's doing very good to come up here. We get these foot right here in good shape. But this right here, when he's like this and the strength and this arm straight, let's see it like this. I'm going to take my finger. Don't let me go this way, right? You ready? Come on, come on, come on. All right. So now let's get in that same position. And instead with these arms out, I want to get this elbow bent right here, strength. And when its elbow is bent, I've got something behind the baseball. I'm going to take my full hand. Now don't let me. Ready? Now he can tell you I'm not playing a trick on you. You're stronger, right?
I guess.
He guesses. Oh, you don't help me out at all. Thank you very much. What's your name? Ben. All right, thank you. Didn't work. Nah. But he can tell I'm putting a lot more force. The issue is I've got something after contact. I'm not fully extended here, and now anybody can come and pull this bat back. Because when I actually make contact with the ball, I mean, there is reverb. I mean, there's actually contact. The force of the ball is coming in. If I don't have enough force going forward, it's going to have a little back. But what I've got is this strength behind the ball. So now I'm a lot stronger here to go through it. To do that, I like to think of it, the whole swing as a car with rear wheel drive. I personally hardly did anything with my front side. Maybe that's why I'm coaching now and not playing anymore, but I don't know. I like to think not. But with this back side, it's this back knee, this back foot, hip, arm, hands. This is what I want y'all to be using to drive your swing. When I get into this part of it, the pull action, this shoulder pulls out, this hip pulls out, this foot pulls out. A lot of bad things can happen. When I'm using my backside, I'm here and I'm coming through, I'm driving through the ball. It's hard to do this when I'm using a thinking mentality of my backside. So when I'm here, I'm coming through my knee,
coming through with my back foot, my back hand, and go through it with my elbow and extend through. Two hands, one hand finish, I don't care. As long as there's two hands on the bat when you're making contact, right? Personally, at the level you're gonna be at in Little League, two hands is the best. As you get older, you can do what you want and all that kind of stuff. But with two hands, what I'm able to do is get through the ball fully and finish up. High finishes is a key thing. What a high finish does for me is it keeps my body back. When I'm here, let's say I'm gonna finish and roll my wrist and finish low, how much more my body went forward, how much straighter my leg is. By simply allowing a hitter to finish high, it gets my body right in line, my knee is bent, I've stayed back, stayed through the ball. So, I'd like to talk about when you're finishing high with one hand, all we would do is we're up here. If a hitter's going to one hand swing at the end, one hand finish, I want this top hand up by your head. When it's down here, that's that level swing here. I mean, when you come out forward. So we've talked about our feet, we've talked about our legs, our body. We'll get to the hands now. With my hands, again, simple part of it. My fingers, lay the bat flat, get them into this line right here, close my hand, and bring it up. A lot of people say line up your door knocking knuckles. For me, that makes my wrist a little uncomfortable. Somewhere in between. The biggest problem is when you got the bat in your palms, not much strength in it. So everybody can do this if they'd like to, take their finger and put it right into their palm and grip it as hard as they can, and now try to pull it out. All right, now do the same thing, that little line I showed you, grip it as hard as you can, and now try to pull it out. The strength factor is in here, it's in your fingers, it's not in your palms. So get the bat into the strength of your hands. All right, with the hands, as I'm loading, we talked about separation, we talked about going back here. This first movement of my hands, when I think about it, is either, this is one thing I really want to harp on. Every hitter is different because we can't, they're not robots. I got kids that I tell to bring their hands up, and then I've got kids that tell their hands back. We look at their swing first, where it is, and then you have to tell them differently. That's why sometimes I'll tell a kid we're going to start throwing linear stuff because they swing like this because they're leaning back. I've got to get some motion going forward. With the hands, what is typical and what is going to give you the best chance of success? Hands right off the shoulder, I mean right off your chest right here, bat's normal at a little 45 degree angle as you can see, and all we do is bring it off about a fist. All right, now that's natural, it's normal, and the barrel is still at an angle. What that does though is allows the hitter to come up with the hand so I can go down. So I want to, you know, think of adages that say, load up, swing down, heard that, whatever it is. When a coach tells you to keep your hands high, let's see if this would be a good swing. Is that a good load right there? All right, so we understand what you're trying to say with keep your hands high, but it might be a little miscommunication is, the important part is this barrel. Keep the barrel high, all right? And what I mean by that is, like I said, this becomes this. When this barrel drops, this drops, and everything else. So what I'm doing is, if I start my hands this high, now what are they gonna do? They're either gonna go higher, because that's not natural, or if I start them this high, they're gonna drop, and if unless you're Josh Hamilton, that hitch, you're not gonna be able to catch up with it, right? Okay, so we're hands here, we're just off the chest, 45 degree angle. We're loading up, it's just a little pushback. It's almost like they used to call it a reverse C here as I'm loading, and it's coming when my foot's going forward. So now, when my foot's going forward, I've got this load going up. Now my first movement is this knob, I want to take it down to the ball, because a lot of hitters will start getting here and this knob goes here. When this knob goes here, that bat flattens out. That happens a lot, where it's an upward swing, or it's a long swing where I get jammed a lot. So when I'm doing it like this, as I'm coming down, this knob keeps coming down, down, as I'm making contact. Obviously, hitter, the young hitters here, when this bat comes down on the ball, that's when backspin, right? That's when you drive it. This here, when I'm coming up, it hits the ball, and I either get topspin or it goes straight up in the air, right? When I hit a fly ball, what has to happen for me to get out? Huh? Yeah. That's it. That's all they have to do. When I hit a fly ball, they catch it, I'm out. When you hit a line drive, obviously catch it, you're out. Hard ground balls, they have to catch it, they have to throw it, and catch it again before you get to first base. So think of, I mean, just the pure, simple part of the game, I want to give myself the best chance of getting success and get on base, hitting the ball down. By doing that, I'm here and coming down through the ball. So the knob is leading down, the hands are coming forward, and the last thing is that bat, when I get right here, and I'm through it, okay? All right, so from this angle, and not hitting it, when I'm going to opposite field, so that I'm lining this up to where it would be an opposite field hit. By the way, any pitchers here, raise your hand. So what's the first pitch you throw to a batter? Fastball. And is it inside or outside usually? Outside, yes. Little League, I'd say it's at least 70%, maybe even more in Little League. The first pitch is a fastball outside, right? So as a hitter, what should I look for on the first pitch? Yeah. Doing that, that's where my focus is. I'm looking for a fastball outside. Now, if they throw me an inside fastball, it's hard. As you're younger, as you're older, you'll realize that's not what you're looking for and just let it go. But now, if you get that pitch, I've got to be able to turn on it. So now I'm here, and turn on it means just hit it. Sorry, not turn on it. So on the outside pitch, I've loaded, that knee is locked about right there. I don't want to go any further. And as my hands are in front, I'm extending through with my hand, finishing. And as a left-handed hitter, we got the advantage closer to first base, right? How many left-handed hitters? Good job, you already got an advantage. When I was young, and I'm talking 10 months old or however young I was to pick up a bat, I went like this. And my dad jumped out of his chair and switched it every time. And it's a story he likes to tell anyway. So if it's wrong, you can correct me. Now, as a left-handed hitter, though, what I've got to make sure I do is stay on the ball. There's an extreme. Ichiro, right? He's already coming out of the box. He knows what he's doing, right? He's got 3,000 hits between Japan League and here. As a left-handed hitter, I got to make sure I stay in the box and take my full swing with this shoulder down on target, my hand, my eyes on target here, and then I swing. It's about like a pitcher that makes a pitch and wants to hurry and get in a good fielding position. I'd much rather make a good pitch and maybe so-so fielding position than to make a pitch and be perfect, right? Because that hitter's got a much harder chance or much tougher job to hit on a good pitch. So, as a hitter, I want to take a good swing, boom, and then run, okay? As a right-handed hitter, the advantage for you is, if anything, if we're ever falling, if we're ever off balance, we want it to be over the plate. So as a right-handed hitter, I'm able to stay here and hit it, and then I'm running, because especially as a right-hander, this is a huge disadvantage. If I pull off on a ball and now I have to run, how much more disadvantage am I? So, excuse me, getting back to it, left-handed hitter, going through the ball. As I'm hitting, I'm going to go outside with all of this because 70% of the pitches are outside, especially with a metal bat, right? Metal bats don't break. Well, I've seen one. But I'm here, full motion, all the way through. My balance is down. We like to take a baseball and split it between our feet. And as I hit, that knee is right over that baseball. It's like a straight line up here. I've got this shoulder down a little bit instead of up here, out this way. I've got my eyes and my shoulder on contact. One more time. Here. And it's one thing I haven't talked about at all, and I should have. Front foot. With the load, this toe is basically going to set me up for failure or success. This front toe. And what I mean by that is, how many step here? When I open up, opens up this hip, this shoulder, and everything. You're not physically going to lead with your heel, but mentally, I want you to think about that. I'm here, and I'm landing on that toe. I'm landing on the toe instead of here. I've already opened myself up. I want to stay as close as I can, as long as I can, to go through it. Kind of advanced point. The foot, when it's loading here, it has got to go down before I start my swing. So as I'm loading and I start swinging like this without that heel going down, I'm going to start spinning. I got to be in a firm footing, because what we are initially or ultimately trying to do is drive with our backside but be firm on our front side. So we want to put as much force this way that we can without falling forward. Doing that is how we stay here, plant this foot as this is coming forward, and now I've got a firm front leg that I can here, but I'm firm and it doesn't allow me to go forward. Here's the issue that we have with how much force we go forward. When this foot goes here and now I swing, this knee bends, right? It's natural. That's how the knee bends. So when this toe opens up, it bends. When I stay closed, that's not how my leg works. It's going to keep me back. So in the long short of the whole thing, I'm putting as much force as I can through the ball and staying back, right? And so I'm going forward and staying back at the same time. How do I do that? I stay closed here. I go the force here, but I'm hitting against a firm front leg. So at some point, your body has actually got to stop. Your body's actually got to stop. I'm going to go a little bit of angle here. And what I mean by that is I'm going forward. My body cannot keep coming forward, because then the swing is getting further out. Your body takes you to a spot and you stop. And now you're in a good position to take your swing. Just like pitching, think of it like this. And as I'm pitching here, if my body keeps coming forward, my arm has got to go out and around it. At some point, if I'm pitching or even playing catch, I'm here, and now my body has stopped as I rotate through and let this arm come down and do its thing. Hitting with the same thing. My body's coming forward, but it's got to stop to allow me to hit. Any more questions so far? Yes. Good question. When it gets here, again, for me, it's all about extremes. If I get here and I can not move my head, but if I can look at the corner of my eye and see the barrel, it's too far. What it's called, like you're asking, is a wrap. When you get right here, what it makes is a long swing, because it's got to come from here all the way around. So I like to, and I know I'm not going to wrap like this, that be weird. So if I'm keeping my 45 degree angle, like we try here, it's going to stay right in there. Because the thing about it is, the pitcher's providing a lot of energy, a lot of force with his pitch. So we don't need to put as much effort into the swing as we think we do. When I get a kid, and I'll say it's last one, and they always want to rip one, but they want to swing hard. So like to get that out of your mind. It's not swinging hard, it's swinging quick. So if we have a quick swing, that terminology again, I'm here, it's a quick swing instead of my muscles get all tense, I try to choke the bat and all kinds of other things. So I want to be nice and loose. Makes another point here, I'm here. It's not going to be all around and about like this, but it's nice and relaxed. We're not choking the bat. At some point when we load, now, that's when the strength comes in here to make my swing. I'm not choking it here, white knuckled and everything. Okay, any good question? Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. What is the drawback you feel to overstriding?
Good. So overstriding, when I'm here and a good base, when I stride too far, what I've done is now torque is the word we know. Kids might not know it yet, but I can't get anything going. So if I tried to hit a ball here, and I'm gonna give a good effort, it slows my swing down because I'm not able to get any force here. When I'm quicker, I mean, there used to be a drill where they put a basketball or something between your legs here and you hit and you had to keep it there. I mean, that's a little outdated, but the point of it is basically the closer my knees are, the more torque I'm gonna have. Now there's happy medium, obviously. We're not gonna be there, but I want to be here. What it's doing is it's allowing me to have a little torque. So think about it, kids, you've seen ice skating before. When they're spinning around really fast, are they like this or are they like this? Yeah. So that's when I'm quick. That's when I'm able to turn on a dime, right? When they want to slow down, they spread out their arms. So as a hitter, I'm learning from that. I can draw something from that. I'm here and I'm inside my body. When I load, I like to tell some of my hitters, we're going to go elbow in if they need it. Some hitters get here, that elbow's up and that bat's going to follow this way. When this elbow tucks in to my body here, this elbow tucks in as I'm hitting. The closer I am to my body, the quicker I am, the more force hopefully I'll be able to get on the ball. And again, that's not everybody. Like I said, some people, I know Jerry Sansbury, worked with him in a camp the last couple weekends ago. He gets way back here, but it works for him. He's in the major league, so he's doing something right, right? Okay. Any other questions? Yeah. Oh, sorry. Okay. Finishing the swing, when I'm here and I've finished my swing and my head is on the ball and I'm down and this shoulder is down. Matt Williams is an old name for the Giants, but he would overcompensate and get this shoulder around my chin here. And as he'd swing, that chin's going down because he wants to keep his head down from shoulder to shoulder. Just something, maybe it works for you. Also, while I'm here, I want to talk a lot, actually, about the mental side of the game. Dealing with failure. So if you fail, what do they say, 7 out of 10 times, you could be a Hall of Famer. And I failed, I hit 280 was my career, 10 years. 280. Little League, 600, whatever. Middle school, 550. High school, 500. Senior year of high school, hit 330. How'd I get drafted? Talent, maybe, but I hit one ball that probably went 450 feet, best ball I've ever hit, and a scout was there to see me. He saw me, I could do it one time. The coaches then think they can teach you to do it over and over again. The results of the game, though, are very hard to deal with. There's ways to go about it. One thing used to help me a lot, I used to write down everything, what the pitchers would throw and all that kind of stuff, but there's things that can happen. If I've got a good approach, so I go up into the plate, it's my first at bat of the game, I'm not really loose. How hard is it for me to take a good swing on that first pitch that he throws? Pretty hard. I'd like the pitcher to start throwing some strikes. If it's that best pitcher they have, we want to get him out of the game, make him throw a lot of pitchers. I know there's pitch counts now in Little League. Thank goodness they weren't when I came along. But now I want to get him out of the game. I got to have a good approach. Maybe take the first pitch. I'm seeing it. But when you're taking a pitch, and maybe that coach is giving you the take, that doesn't mean go like this. You didn't get anything out of it, right? You're upset that the coach gave you the take. Get something out of it. That means load. Okay, I'm ready on the next one. All right, so if I have a good approach and a good result. So I get a line drive to left center for a base hit. What's going to be my response? Good or bad? Good, right. Good approach, good results, going to have a good response. And that's how I dealt with it. How about a good approach? I'm ready, I'm on point, line drive, shortstop catches it, out. So a good approach, bad result. How am I going to feel as a hitter? Should. Definitely should feel good. As hitters, man, I got out. Think of it like this. I know it's hard. We got a lot of travel balls and all that kind of other things. Stats, they count in high school and everywhere above. It's just pure stats. The scouts, if they see you, or a college coach eventually, they care about the mechanics because they know talent is going to come through. So if a coach comes and sees you play later on in your life and you go 0 for 4 with two line drives, a shortstop, a deep ball to right center, and a hard ground ball to second, and you think it's the worst thing that's ever happened. No, he's seeing that swing. It's not about the results. So how about a bad approach, a good result? So a bad approach, but we hit a double to right center. What's our response? It's good, yeah, we're happy. Just be thankful it happens. Baseball has a way of going back and forth. It hopefully evens out. But it's how we respond. So I got that result no matter what. That seems like it's the determining factor, how I view my response. Kids, it's not that result. It's that approach. It's hard, I know. Trust me. We hope everybody has a wife as good as mine. The first game she ever saw me play in professional baseball, I went 0 for 4, three ground balls, one to short, two to second, and a strikeout. She said that was the best game she had ever seen because I got three hits, right? I hit the ball three times. That's what she saw. That's the scorekeeper I want. But true story. It's how you approach, how you respond, and get over those tough games or whatever. You're going to have a lot of success, but you're going to have a lot of failure too. Personally, baseball is a great sport because it teaches you about life too. How much do you have to deal with failure in baseball and then go into life? How you respond to adversity at home versus adversity on the field. How about guys that struck out in here and take it to the field and make an error? Who's done that? Yeah. Be truthful about it. I know I have. As hard as it is, we want to have success. We want to help the team succeed too. If I get a good hit, they catch it, I'm out, and I mope around and don't even get the out. Now I've doubled it, and it's called quicksand. It just keeps coming and over, and it piles on. As hard as it is, have baseball players, we need short-term memories bad. As soon as it happens, whatever it is, get rid of it. Because the thing about it is, you're not as good as your best at bat, and you're not as bad as your worst one. So that best hit that I've ever had, that's not me. It just happened. And my worst game was 0 for 5 with 3 Ks. That's not me either. Somewhere in between. And speaking of that, baseball is a lot of this, right? A lot of peaks and valleys. 3 for 4, 0 for 4, 4 for 5, 1 for 5, whatever it is. Those are tough to deal with. As a hitter, 1 for 3s, 2 for 4s, 2 for 5s, all that kind of stuff to stay in that little. And again, it's about staying out of the extremes as hard as it is. How much more time do I have? A little bit more. Any questions before I go any more? Yes, sir.
You made a comment that you wanted a high pitch.
Yes. Yes, completely. When he's saying here about a high finish, when I'm coming down, this knob is coming down, and now I've made contact and I've hit through, the swing contact is over. And now what that high finish, it's kind of like I tell my kids, well, sometimes we'll freeze here and get here, and they take one of their best swings because they know where they have to end up. The swing, if I start it 45 degree angle, if I start it here and finish here, there's a much higher chance of taking that good swing. It's going to be that swing that's coming down, going through the ball, and staying back in the same breath. Because when I get here, if I start here, it's going to come here, and now it's going to keep going and bring my body forward. One of the hardest things to teach is to stay back on this back leg. What I mean by that is this little muscle right here above your knee,
this one right here, it should be burning if you're not used to it when you're done hitting. And I mean by that is I'm here and this thing's down. This heel is up. It's not flat back here. When I have a flat heel, I mean a flat foot, that leg's gonna be straight. If anybody plays golf, no, we don't want that either, right? So when I'm here, this knee is bent. I'm down on the ground and go through. That was one more. Yes, sir.
So you hear the term a lot, swing a knob to the ball. Mm.
I mean, terminology, however it works to get, I mean, it's to teach the kid and everything, my knob, I like bringing it down, no, whether it's to the ball, that's kind of getting away from the body if I'm going actually to the ball. And I don't want to get away because if you're the pitcher here and I'm taking it to the ball because it's coming from there. So the terminology might not be the best in that to the ball because it might get them here instead of bringing the knob down. Maybe in the angle to the ball, but I'm bringing it down to swing through because when that knob comes here, it's that flat swing that rolls over a lot.
Does it matter how high your
shot
is?
How, I'm
sorry? Okay,
I'm lifting the leg up or not. Timing, man, I haven't even talked about that. Timing, so much important for hitting is timing. Kids, when you're on the on-deck circle, don't be waving at mom and dad and all this kind of stuff and messing around, picking your gum up and kicking it or whatever. Timing the pitcher. He's throwing to that guy, you're going to be next. I know y'all might have to stay in the dugout right now though, right? Or are you outside the dugout? Okay, good. So when you're there, get that pitcher, he's over there now because I'm in the first base dugout. Time it. Now, again, I want to make it as simple as possible. So if I do this, it makes it more difficult to be on time. So when I'm thinking like this, I'm stepping to hit. A lot of people say when you step to hit, as soon as that foot lands, you're swinging. We want to think of it as step and hit, or reach and hit, as I said earlier. And what I mean by that is there's that small pause. I'm here and then swing. It's not going to be fully all one motion. Obviously, the bat at some point has to stop going backwards to go forwards. So obviously there is a small pause, it might be that much. But with your exact question, if I'm up here, it might be in the air too long and now the ball's here. So it's good, it's possible, but it's gonna limit your chance of success right now. As you get older and you learn, this is when I'm gonna throw, as the pitcher's getting right here and showing me his back, showing mine or whatever it is. Some guy might throw a little harder, might get started sooner, right? Okay. Is there any, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. It's a good question. Again, no robots, but everybody is different. And here's another thing. If a coach tells you one way and a hitting instructor tells you another way, especially when you get into school ball, your baseball coach makes the lineup. As tough as it is, you know, it's not the best scenario sometimes, but well, my hitting coach told me to do this. Well, he's not here, is he? That thing. So it's, be careful with the coaches and everything, especially parents. I know it's tough sometimes, but with a particular question, with my numbers, when I get here, what I've done is it's hard to see that pitcher when I turn this much, and I know this isn't comfortable. So if I'm showing my numbers, it creates this swing. And when I want the swing, I want to be going here. I want to be going here to go that way. So there's gonna be a little bit of tuck with the shoulder, just as this coming in, but I don't want you to think of it as the body is moving. It's this. My shoulder's just pushing back here instead of that, right? Okay, good question. I think we're pretty close to time with everything. Does anybody have any more questions? So did you go to that purpose-driven baseball camp?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was at that camp. Were you there? Very good.
there's no other questions, I don't want to talk fast pitch softball tonight, so whole different swing. But that's it. Thank you very much for your time, and I think we'll have a little bit of break for a few minutes, and if you do have any questions you don't want to ask here, I'll be over here. Ask them, please, all you want. Thank you again.
Like that's past. And we have a shady driver, we're talking about baseball, just